Welcome everyone to the South by Southwest live stream for the UK's Department for International Trade. I'm your host, Jimmy Conrad, and I'm here at the Great Britain House in Austin, Texas, where we're going to talk about and with a few British companies that are driving innovation in the tech space. And I'm happy to be joined by two of those people and their leaders right now, right, your businesses. I'm here with the Plansnap CEO, Louise Doherty. Thank you so much for your time. Tim Brownstone, the CEO for KYMIRA Sport. Now, to give us some context about why you guys are here, tell us a little bit about your companies, and Tim, you can go first.
Okay. So, KYMIRA starts off as a technical sportswear brand. So what we do is we basically capture energy from the wearer, and then that's re-emitted in the form of infrared, and that basically supercharges your cells, and as an athlete, that enhances performance and accelerates recovery. But the mission for that was bigger, which was basically to take that technology and transcend into the medical market, so the benefits that we can deliver go beyond just helping someone to perform a bit better.
Okay, my mind is blown. You just said infrared, and I was like, what is happening? I need to get more on that. But Louise, I want to go to you and talk about Plansnap.
So Plansnap is the fastest way to get friends together. It's an app that lets everyone agree on the four things that you need to make plans happen: who, what, where, and when.
Okay, so I'm really popular. I think this app could help me a ton. Now, with regard to this infrared technology, I'm a former pro athlete. Pat myself on the back for that. So I'm really curious about this product in particular because athletes are superstitious.
Yeah.
So not only are you trying to differentiate yourself in the market, you're also trying to get some loyalty from athletes who have their little quirks, and it's hard to win their trust in some capacity.
Yeah. So, I mean, I come from a scientific background, so it was really important to me from the word go that we were clinically validating everything. So right now we've got 10 third-party trials that sort of prove the efficacy of our products. And so that goes a long way, more so with sort of the S&C coaches and the physios and doctors. For the players themselves, that comes down to a recommendation. So be that from another player, from a family member, a friend, or what we've done is partnering with sort of healthcare professionals, so working with their physios and with their chiropractors to introduce the products in that manner.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of different ways to attack getting that loyalty.
Definitely.
And then Louise, you're what's interesting about the app market is that it's crowded, and I think we can all agree that sometimes there's just too many apps on my phone, but you figured out a way to kind of make that process a little bit more efficient.
Yeah, that's actually what we're trying to do, is to say all these different apps that you're using to make all your social plans, you don't need them, you just need one, Plansnap. So on average you use 9 apps, 22 app switches, 77 swipes, 13 minutes on the phone, and 10 texts just to make the average plan, just to like go for a beer or catch up with friends.
Okay.
So just one.
Okay, so I get on Plansnap, I get it on my phone. Does anybody else in my group, like I said, I'm popular, I got a ton of friends, so am I the only one that needs the app, or does everybody need it?
So you don't, your friends don't need to have the app for them to make plans with you. So
I'm picking up what you're putting down, and I like it.
So our early users are like super planners. They're like me. They're always scanning, Time Out magazine and like new restaurant recommendations, and are always finding fun things to do. So I've got like 20 different plans on the go all at once. So I've got all these different moving parts, all these people I'm speaking to, and so I need something to keep track of all of that and make the awesome plans happen. Some of my friends, they don't really love to plan things. They don't even really like to do that many things, but they do like to see me occasionally, and so all they need to do is get a text with the information and then just reply to that. So that's what happens. You can just reply to any text and it'll come into the app for me.
That sounds next level.
It's pretty cool.
And I think Tim's sold on that. Okay, so with regard to KYMIRA, in your mission, tell me a little bit about where you are now and then where you're trying to take it.
Okay, so mission for us, as I said, was always to use the sportswear brand as a point to validate and commercialize medical technologies, right? So right now, we have customers on every continent around the world using the sportswear. This is some of our cycle kits about to come out.
I think I would look good in that, by the way.
No, I think so
just
too.
Throwing that out there.
Bring the color out in your eyes.
Exactly.
And we're now starting to prove that model of sportswear, which then goes into the medical side. So we're already working with sort of elderly and infirm patients to help treat chronic disorders such as arthritis, Raynaud's disease, and even some stroke victims. And then behind the scenes, what we're actually working on is taking that concept of the human as a power source a step further, and we're actually doing research into converting that energy into electricity that we can power.
And you call it wasted sensors. Energy.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Which I think is funny because your app also is trying to take away wasted energy.
It's very true.
Yeah.
So, yeah. You guys see what
that's
I did there?
Some
about efficiency.
Yeah, that's why I'm here. And I appreciate the efficiency. Now, with Plansnap, where do you guys go? You're here now. You're starting to make a splash into the market. How do you make it even bigger?
Well, domination obviously is the goal.
Of course. That goes without saying.
I guess we'd be aiming at being like, you know, like the Airbnb for experiences. So anytime you want to do something with another person, we can make that happen, you know, really, really quickly. We started with the app, but, you know, we're really interested in voice. So you can turn around and say, hey, Alexa, you know, who's around for beers? And you come back and get an answer straight away. Being able to book everything seamlessly end to end from, you know, the tickets right through to a car to get you there. Anything that you want to do with another person, we can make that happen.
Okay, and where did you sense the void? I mean, where did this idea germinate from? Were you like, I got it? Because that's a really interesting part of the creative process for me, where you can kind of see the landscape of where things are going, you have this vision, but it's one more step of courage and confidence to say, you know what, I'm going to do something about it.
Yeah, I guess for me, it was a personal problem. So I was just drowning in group chat notifications. I was like, there has to be a better way. Mm-hmm. But my background is actually product marketing and building products for consumer brands. So like BBC, ASOS, CO Sushi, everything that always had community at the center. And I thought, here I am doing all these millions of different sports and all these different, you know, restaurants and pop-up experiences and things. And I know I want to make that easier. And then this is actually what I do in my day job. So it didn't really feel like a big jump. It was just like, right, okay, I'm just going to do it for myself now.
It's funny how that's where it starts, just almost out of the convenience of your own life, and now you can apply that to others. Yeah. But I like where your head's at, Liz. You seem pretty smart.
It's so important, though, because every time you wake up and something's gone wrong, or you know, like you don't know how to put these things back together, you have to look up and go, hey, nobody solved it yet. I'm still going to carry on working.
Yeah. Well, that was my next question, kind of that perseverance to say, hey, it's a little tough right now, I'm dealing with some adversity, but I'm going to continue to push through. And Tim, kind of want to know the genesis of your idea, where it started. You guys in 2013, where it really formed and became something. But when did that idea actually pop into your head?
So the idea first came when I was about 16. I found a NASA research paper where they're using infrared to make plants grow quicker in space. Mm-hmm. And I kind of thought, there must be a similar effect on us as humans. And so in my own time, I started looking into it. But I actually convinced myself, I'm not the guy to put this into sportswear, because I know nothing about design, I know nothing about fabrics. But in 2013, still no one had done it. I was researching the technology and I thought, well, if no one else is going to, I'll just give it a go and see what happens. And 3 years later, you know, we're still
going strong.
Only
3 years, which is quite impressive, because the market that you're trying to get into, even from a global standpoint, it feels like a lot of American companies dominate that. And how do you then kind of navigate that landscape, as it were, to, hey, say, I understand and I respect what you guys are doing, but I've got something special too.
Well, I mean, one of it is I'm quite bold by saying that really sportswear hasn't really truly innovated in my books since maybe compression came from medical into performance sports. Mm-hmm. But I think the key thing to say is that a crowded market is actually easier to break into because the customer is used to looking around. Whereas if it's, you know, if it's just two brands that are dominating everything, it's very hard for a young competitor to get in and even get any sales. Mm-hmm. So while yes, there are big global brands, they only make up about 20% of the market. The rest of the global sportswear is made up of sort of smaller regional brands that either don't have the resources to sort of scale from there, or are entering the market and they're getting to that point.
I think what's interesting about what you guys do and what you've created is you go from this idea of building specific tech that you think is going to help and make things more efficient, but then you have to get into the marketing side where you're like, oh man, not only did I've got this, the idea is done, it's good, it works, but now I got to sell it. Yeah. How's that challenge been for you, Louise?
I'm actually going about this the opposite way. So I'm saying I don't want loads of users. I actually only really want the users who are the super planners. Mm. So if you're like me and constantly planning stuff, then I want you to be invited to Plansnap and to get the access to the best ideas for things to do them in the fastest way so that everyone else is looking at my users and saying, oh great, like they're doing all these cool things. I really want to be on Plansnap. We would rather have like an amazing experience for the 1% of people, well, 20% of people that are the super planners than to have everyone on. I mean, eventually, obviously, everyone is the goal, but like to start with, super users.
Yeah, and then Tim, for you, like, the marketing side of it.
Yeah, I mean, I was coming at this, as I said, as a scientist. So our first struggle was communicating how the technology works in a way that the general consumer isn't just going to go, that's too much science, I'm not interested.
Right.
And actually our first customers, they were all sort of high educational levels, elite athletes, and they wanted to know more about the science. So I thought, oh, that's fantastic, you know, we'll put it up, which then made put everybody else off. So the biggest journey for us has been learning to educate, but to do it in a manner that's readily digestible, it's not going to take you a week to go and research, you know, all of the science behind our products.
Okay, and now let's take this and this idea of marketing. You come from the UK, where it seems like you've made a name for yourself in some capacity. You come over here to the United States. Yeah. That's a nice big hurdle to overcome. It's a big market, and yeah. I think we could argue that the consumers here in the States are open to new things.
Yeah.
Have you seen any challenges or any differences between the two countries or just with your platform in general?
Yeah, I think it's really interesting. We've just taken part in a business accelerator called Techstars in New York. Mm-hmm. And so Plans have started in the UK, and the idea for the product started there. And then building it in New York, we actually were doing a lot of user testing and realized that the two products are slightly different, and the two ways that people make plans in the UK and the US are slightly different. So we've actually developed something which works for both. An example of some of those differences. In the UK, if I say to you, we're going to go for, I don't know, we're going to do a dinner in 3 weeks' time. If you tell me that you're going to be at that dinner in 3 weeks' time, I'll put it in my calendar and I'll be there. I won't speak to you beforehand because I don't need to. I've got it in my calendar, I'll be there.
Right.
In the US, particularly New York, you know, you have like triple confirmation. So like the day before, the hour
I live
before.
In New York, so I know exactly what you're saying, and you're right.
Yeah.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. And then the second thing is that in the UK, we use messaging platforms like WhatsApp quite frequently to make plans.
Yeah.
But in the US, it's more about text message. So that's where the idea for text message integration came from.
I see. And then for you, Tim, when you look at the US market in general.
Well, I mean.
There's a lot of athletes here.
Yeah, there's a lot of athletes.
We have more people.
It's the biggest sports bet market in the world. Mm. It's very much, for us, we're trying to enter into what we call institutional. So that's collegiate sports, and that's on the sort of professional side. But we do find that the sort of, as you said, the consumer is a lot more open. Mm-hmm. You know, in Europe, we're quite conservative as a consumer market. So it was a lot easier for us to get that word of mouth sort of initial market entry, just because friends told friends, family members told family members, and we can actually see a new zip code, you know, we'll post, which we fulfill from the UK, and then new sales will radiate out from that point. Mm-hmm. So it's quite nice to see sort of that initial genesis in a new area, and then see it sort of expand from there.
Okay.
I would say the same is probably true in consumer tech as well. Obviously, America is like held up as like the pinnacle of all that's good in tech. You know, like the big tech companies come from here. Mm-hmm. And I think that's true when you're looking at new consumer apps and products. Like, people are a lot more willing to try things. And because just how many people there are over here, you know, the opportunity for us is massive.
Yeah. Now, you guys have this trade mission. Mm-hmm. It's part of why you're over here.
Yep.
And you guys probably have similar struggles in how you're growing your business. Do you guys ever share philosophies or work together, or kind of like, we're British companies, we're going to come over here and
well, Louise,
lean on each other in some
Louise
ways?
Dragged me up a mountain on a cycle trip, which, you know, that was quite helpful. But yeah, you know, it's all a shared struggle, and it doesn't necessarily just have to be, you know, British companies helping British companies. You know, if we know friends in Austin that can help sort out, you know, arranging meetings or somewhere to stay, and then, you know, you pay that back. So when someone comes to London for a tech conference, you know, we're there to help them. And, you know, what goes around does come around.
Right. And then how important is the influence of the UK coming to this event and putting your British flavor on what's happening here in Austin? Louise, I'll go with you.
Yeah, I think it's amazing. I mean, think about all the awesome tech companies that have been launched at South By. It's kind of like where you go if you're going to come and launch a tech product.
Yeah.
So making sure that there's a British representation here and support to get here as well, because it's not cheap, you know, as an early stage startup. So like, we really appreciate the trade mission. That, like, the house itself is incredible, and it's a real destination to bring, you know, customers, investors, you know, to come and meet us here and to see our product.
Yeah. I think that's that point of having somewhere that you can call sort of home and your sort of central location during South By, that you know, you're proud to bring, as Louise says, investors or meetings to, but also it's brand Britain is big enough to attract, you know, people just to come and see what's going on and maybe discover us when they wouldn't have known about us beforehand.
Are there any competitors here for you guys? Not just from UK based, but overall, and when you see them, let's take this one more step. Be like, those guys are nothing. What we have is so much better.
I mean, we've got competitors on the accelerator.
Yeah.
None of them are sort of tech, sportswear, or wearable technologies. But they're, you know, they do have some interesting ideas that we can sort of cross-pollinate that sort of innovation process. Obviously, yes, we do have competitors
in
the US.
Yeah, that goes without saying. Yeah, just know if you saw them down the street, it's like a gang fight in the alley.
To be honest, I often think, you know, and I used to think when we went to trade fairs, you know, oh, we shouldn't be speaking to them because they're the competition. But actually, they're the people that know your struggles. You know, they know your pain points the most. So actually, you end up building that camaraderie. And while you may, you know, once the customers arrive, you're vying for their business. At the end of the day, you go and have a beer with them, and you know, you relax because they know how it feels.
Right. And then with Plansnap, is there? I mean, you seem like you've got no competition in some ways. I mean, you do with certain apps that might do a little bit of what you're doing, but nothing as specific.
Yeah. I mean, if there was something that could end to end make all of my plans for me, you know, in two taps like Plansnap can, like, I wouldn't have bothered building it.
Yeah, right.
You know, Facebook events can't tell you which day to have your birthday on based on who you really want to be there. That's the sort of thing that Plansnap can do. So no, there isn't really a competitor.
Okay, and then let's get back into the technology a little bit more, because the infrared, like I said before, mind-blowing. How do you take that technology and adapt it to the human body? And how does it, because I feel like I'm going to put it on and be Superman.
Yeah.
But I'm sure it's a little more complicated than that, and there's probably some nuance that I'm just skipping about 15 steps on that.
Yeah.
Maybe explain a little bit of that.
So without going too technical, basically how we achieve the infrared emission is we embed pre-selected minerals into the yarns that we use to make our fabrics. Uh-huh. And so all of those have been selected for their emission spectrum and the biological effects that induces in the human body. Mm-hmm. Now, while you know there are similar effects in sort of animal cells and plant cells, as I mentioned earlier, we've fine-tuned that again to make sure that we're optimizing for human performance and human recovery.
Okay, I like the recovery part a lot. I think there's a lot of, that sometimes gets skipped. Everybody wants to talk about performance, but you can't perform at a high level if you're not recovering properly.
And I think the recovery side, it's not just sports these days. You know, we're seeing recovery specialists going and working in corporate environments to optimize workplace and increase productivity. And that's so important. You know, sleep is vital. Without sleep, you know,
yeah, of course.
We've all worked long nights, and we all know how we feel after that.
Yeah.
And I think it's very much that recognition now of the sort of the general well-being. While some of it's becoming, you know, it's a trend, that's a good thing, because people are listening to their bodies, and they're going, okay, I'm working hard 7 days in the gym, but I'm still not reaching my goals. I'm not feeling great. And why is that? Well, your cortisol levels are through the roof. So it's about knowing what works for you, and then products like both of ours that help facilitate, you know, optimize and improve your day-to-day life.
Do the recovery features work for South by Southwest hangovers? Because I think you'll be doing a roaring trade if so.
Hangovers we haven't tested yet, but we did have a cartoonist over in the Netherlands who, he basically, his vision of Kymira was a guy in a suit at a trade show after 5 days just going, yeah, I feel great. And someone just like, oh, I feel awful. How are you still going? And he said, well, I'm wearing my Kymira, so, you know,
that's great.
I'm good.
Now, this might sound like a silly question, but can you sleep in this? Is there a benefit to sleeping?
Yeah.
Because I would totally rock your PJs.
So,
like,
you know,
Kymira PJs.
We sort of say 24/7 is best.
Yeah.
We appreciate not everyone wants to walk around in Lycra 24/7.
Yeah.
So we're actually developing sleep systems now. So both mattresses, sort of bed clothing. But we've got athletes that they just sleep in sort of their leggings or their tops, travel to competitions
right,
in them.
Right.
Because, you know, we are a young company, which means that if, you know, we're not endorsed by, for example, Team GB at the Olympics, which means that our athletes could wear it up to the competition point, but then they'd have to change into their team kit because, you know, we're not a team sponsor, we're not an official provider.
Yet.
Yes. So
I like that positivity.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
So it's about getting that sort of, giving as much as we can to the athlete to get them in the best possible position going into the race.
Got it. And then, Louise, I want to know more about just some advice that you could give to people that might be looking to get into this space or have an idea but maybe don't have the confidence to take that next step. You seem very hyper-focused because it was so near and dear to your heart, but and that might be for other people too, but what kind of spurred you on to say, I'm going to do it, and what advice did you get to kind of keep you pointed in the right direction?
Yeah, I would say think about how you would feel in 5 years' time if you don't do it. That's what really motivated me. It was similar to you, you know, you kind of think, oh, should I do it? Do I have all the skills? Is this the right idea for me to do it? How am I going to bring it to life? I just get all of those things out of your head and just start, like, take the first step and then the next step and then tell people about it. And then, you know, you get all this help and support. And then all of a sudden, like a couple of years later, you're like, great, I have a proper company now.
And I feel fascinated when I come to South By because you walk into people, all walks of life, who all had a dream or an idea and just took that first step not knowing for sure if they knew what they were doing, but they're going to go for it anyway because they believe in their vision. And so I really appreciate what you guys do.
And I think that taking that first step, you know, you can go and read books about it, but until you're actually doing it,
right,
you know, learn on your feet, be adaptive, and you know, that's what's going to set you apart, is that it's not so much just an attitude to risk, it's a get on and give it a go.
Now, you had to share your idea in some ways because, like you said, you didn't know how to do the fabric or the design. I mean, how did that feel to kind of have to release some control? Because as idea people, we like control. Mm-hmm. So what did you do to kind of, I mean, I guess you, to, you know, have your idea become realized, you had to concede some things, but it's still your baby.
I mean, on the control side, I think it was, to start with, it was a recognition that these people are better than me. So to get the best products, you know, they need to be involved in the project. Mm-hmm. I, of course, had that fear that every, especially tech startup has of, I don't want to tell people about it because then that's going to steal my idea.
Right, right. It's my IP. It's my intellectual property.
Exactly. Yeah. But very quickly you realize that, you know, people are either too busy working on their own projects or not everyone's out there to sort of to get in your way or steal your ideas. And at the end of the day, collaboration makes things go a lot quicker. Mm-hmm. When it came to getting a team on the other hand, you know, I was a sole founder and I was used to just things being in my head. Mm-hmm. And then it was a sort of a dilemma of, well, I like things done my way, but at the same time, I just don't have enough time. So it was kind of, please take, you know, take the workload and help me out here.
Yeah, right.
So we were at a good time when we started to expand that I didn't have that sort of precious, it's my baby, because I was, you know, I was overworked and I needed, we needed to grow.
And then Louise, same for you. You have this idea and you, at some point, you're going to need some help to see it to where it is now. How is that in terms of?
Amazing.
Okay, great.
Do you know what it's like to carry an idea around in your head for that long?
Yeah.
And then suddenly you can share it with people and then they'll pick it up and they'll take it and they'll put their own spin on it. And ultimately, you know, diverse teams and ways of thinking solve big problems.
Right.
And so if you want to solve a big problem, you have to share it. You have to get on board people with different specialisms. And it, as a solo founder, like, it's such a pleasure to be able to come in and say, hey, there's four other people that are working towards the same thing as me.
I guess in that same vein, did you then have your idea and then now it's evolved and morphed into something else? You're like, actually, this is better than what I thought it was going to be. Did you run into that at all?
Yeah, well, I mean, I guess the best example I could give from Kymira's standpoint is originally we wanted to take the infrared tech into medical applications.
Mm-hmm.
We're sort of doing that, but the money it requires for the clinical validation and everything on sort of a biological lab, it's beyond our means at the moment. So actually, we've taken the energy harvesting concept a step further, which was, you know, it was a cool idea, but it wasn't something I initially intended. But the way that the team and the company's evolved, we've sort of, I guess, we've pivoted to developing that line instead. You know, and that's really exciting for me. You know, it means that we can innovate again while still growing, you know, the brand as well alongside it.
Okay, now one of the challenges of growth, and maybe you have or haven't run into this, is other companies coming in to buy you that are bigger. And then that becomes a struggle of, do I relinquish that control fully and basically, you know, get my money and run, or do I continue to maintain my vision and stick with what I believed in the first place? I don't know, you don't have to acknowledge one way or the other, but I'm sure it's a challenge, and would you embrace it if that possibility arose?
The first time that somebody offered to buy Plansnap before we'd launched, I was like, what? but it's kind of nice because it's somebody saying, oh, you know, you're really onto something. And especially in the like consumer tech space, you get a lot of acqui-hires. People say, oh, you built a really great team. You're working on something which we consider to be a feature of a bigger product.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I guess it's nice when people say those things. But when you set out, you have this, you know, you're forced to say, oh, I'm going to put together a big, massive vision. And unless you're through to a point where you think that you've had a really good crack at it, we're definitely not there. I'm still 100% Plansnap.
Yeah.
Well, one of the big conversations here in the States is that Snapchat turned down getting bought by Facebook, which is the most popular, most talked about. And now the valuation for Snapchat's huge. But the flip side of them turning down Facebook is that Facebook bought Instagram and now created a whole platform that's basically Snapchat.
Mm-hmm.
Do you fear that if you turn down somebody that they will just try to build a competitor?
The consumer tech space is ruthless like
that.
Yeah,
yeah.
You know, but you have to think about, as with any other business, what do you have that's defendable, and what unfair advantage do you have against other businesses? And so I feel very sorry, actually, for Snapchat that Facebook have replicated many of their features elsewhere.
Yeah.
You just got to watch out for it.
And I think it goes beyond the product, though. You know, these days it's the service you're providing and it's everything around the products and the brands, which can still differentiate you. You can still maintain customer loyalty. You know, we are lucky that there isn't anyone else trying to encroach in our space right now, but if someone does, you know, well, actually, Under Armour, they have an infrared technology. It's different to ours.
Right.
But, you know, they are trying to enter the infrared space. We can differentiate on the technology side, but also by providing a different service, because we are a smaller customer company, we can pay more attention to our customers and our users.
Right.
And you know, that maintains the customer loyalty.
Okay. Yeah, that's really interesting.
Being smaller, you've got the advantage of speed. So even if you see trends further upstream in your market, you can say, great, well, I'm going to act on that now in the next week or so. Whereas other companies, it might take them a year, 18 months, 2 years. That's the company that I mentioned earlier. They'd said to us, what you've just shown us is 2 years worth of our roadmap. We cannot do that fast enough. So in fact, we'd really like to, you know, partner with you.
All right, now what I want to know, this is a, kind of a fun question, maybe just for me, but I hopefully you guys think it's interesting too. You started off with this idea. And now it's just taken off. You're probably wearing more hats than you ever thought possible. What's the most fun hat to wear? The unexpected hat that you thought, oh, this is a pretty cool perk from starting this idea, and the other one going, I am so exhausted. Can this just end already? I think that's fun to see because it humanizes your brand a little bit and what you're doing because there's so much heart and soul into the product.
I mean, I think the most fun thing for me, and to be honest, it's not really a Kymira hat per se, but it's actually going back to the grassroots and talking about innovation and talking about how we are trying to do it differently. And you know, that's our viewpoint. Doesn't necessarily mean it's going to work for everyone. But then seeing someone feel inspired, you know, in the audience, or you know, they'll come up to you or send you a message afterwards, and that's sort of I find that the most fun and the most rewarding, because you know you've made that impact and you've potentially done what someone did for me, which was encourage me to take that leap and you know move forward with my idea.
Yeah, it's interesting. Mine's actually the same, but in a different space. So inspiration, but for female founders. So I wanted to start a business for probably 10 years before I actually did it. And I wasn't sure like who to speak to, what kind of role models there were, you know, how I would go about like building a team on any of those things. There wasn't really anyone to look to and say, that's how you do it. And I think that's still evident today in that, you know, like there are far fewer female founders than there are male founders, and also from any other kind of minority. Only 7% of women are backed by venture capital, and that has to change, because if we're not putting women's solutions to global problems out there, then we're missing a huge chunk of ideas of kind of good for the world and also profits. So I really enjoy, you know, talking and supporting women in tech and mentoring, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I have two daughters, so this is very relevant to me, just with regard to your role as a CEO and a leader. How have you been received in this space? You find it more challenging, I assume.
Yeah, I mean, men and women are different, and the way that people respond to you within business are different. In some respects, I would say it's been absolutely no different. You know, people have treated me exactly the same. But then, you know, you do hear horror stories of the 4 p.m. coffee meeting with an investor that turns into 5 p.m. drinks, and actually it's like, oh, you're not actually going to pitch me, are you? That happens. It really does, and people don't talk about it. So I would probably say that my experience has been 90% good, but the 10%, like, they do happen.
Interesting. And then let's talk about the future. 5 years from now, Tim, what's your brand looking like?
5 years from now, well, we've well and truly captured the US market. You know?
Under Armour. Great. People don't even talk about Under Armour anymore.
Who is right? that, right?
Like, who? What?
So, you know, the sportswear brand's expanded to a point that it's continually just funding the R&D. But within 5 years, we'll then see the next range of products coming out. So we'll still be using iron thread tech, but we'll then be layering in the sparks of garments and fabrics on top of that, so that we can actually provide an entirely new experience to the customer, and then start moving into that medical space. As I say, that's always the goal for us, is to do more than just producing sportswear.
Yeah, and then Plansnap, what 5 years, what do you envision for your company?
So anytime you meet another person in real life, Plansnap will have helped that happen. So whether that is your friends, as we're currently doing, whether that is your love life, whether that is your kind of like doctor's appointments, anything that you need to do with a group of people, we can make that happen. And that will be across lots of different communication platforms. So we've started with the app, but as we talked about, voice would be great. There's like, you know, messaging apps we can do. It's our algorithm that underwrites the scheduling part of making plans happen.
Okay, and then hypothetically speaking, do you feel like Kymira can be used with Plansnap? Like, hey, we've got a meeting, we're going to have a night out, we should use Plansnap? Because you're the boss, so it's your app that needs to be...
I'm waiting to get my phone out and download it. Honest.
And then for you, you can plan an outing wearing only Kymira stuff.
100%.
Right?
So I think there is a partnership right here. We can organize a South by Southwest cycling meetup where everyone's head to toe in Kymira kit. Done.
Yeah,
got it.
Sorted.
Got it. Well, unfortunately, that is all the time that we have for today, but thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Please support these people. They're doing great things.
Much.
And then also for you guys, we're streaming all week and talking to the best and brightest out of Britain and in the tech space. So on behalf of everybody here, on my guests, and for the UK's Department of International Trade, I'm Jimmy Conrad, and I thank you for watching.